We landed on the moon in 1969, and we haven't been back in 40 years. Why don't we have a moon colony yet?
Science fiction promised us things, and it has failed to deliver.
It's really hard to predict where technology is going to go. We usually think that technology develops sort of step by step, slowly making progress.
Like, you're like, oh, it just keeps iterating. Like, as if by magic, it just keeps getting better, except it doesn't if there's no reason for it to get better.
Progress is almost never just one guy with a smart idea. It requires lots of different people working together to make this stuff become a reality. That's why we don't have a base on the moon, but we do have computers with all the world's information that now fits in our pockets.
Hi, I'm Zach Weinersmith.
And I'm Kelly Weinersmith. I have a PhD in parasitology.
And I draw wiener jokes. And we wrote Soonish.
10 emerging technologies that'll improve and or ruin everything.
Yeah.
Go team.
Cool.
In our book for each technology, we covered three different topics. We talked about what was still needed for each of these technologies to make the technologies work and become part of our lives, how these technologies could make our lives much better, and also how these technologies could potentially make our lives much worse.
Almost everything we researched, we had a pre-existing notion of what it was going to be like that almost invariably was completely upended.
We started looking into it, and we discovered that the people making these predictions don't look to see if there's a long-term market for these technologies.
So we've known how to go to the moon since the late 60s. The problem is it's never gotten any cheaper, and there's nothing up there to bring back to offset the cost.
So right now it costs, on average, $10,000 for every pound of stuff that you want to send to space.
That's $2,500 per cheeseburger. So if you see an astronaut eating an apple in space, you should write your senator.
So if you want to reduce the cost of getting to space, you can try to get the rocket back down without throwing it away after each use, or you could try something totally different. For example, there's an idea called the space elevator, and this idea is supposed to reduce costs of getting stuff to space by 90%. What we're waiting for is a cable to go from Earth out to space, and right now we have no material that's strong enough to make that cable.
So you need this material that's like Superman's hair. It weighs nothing, but it holds everything. Carbon nanotubes are a good candidate because they have this quality. The problem is we can only make them about this long right now, and we need them 100,000 kilometers long, which is more than this long.
Before you're going to get a cable that's long enough, there's going to need to be an economic reason to make them longer for Earth-based uses. So the reason we don't have one continuous carbon nanotube on which you can build a space elevator is economics.
We wanted people to be really optimistic about the future, but also really skeptical.
We thought it was important to consider how technologies could ruin everything so that people were thinking about that ahead of time. So, for example, there's an idea called programmable matter. A bunch of the stuff in your life could be doing a lot more for you than it's currently doing. A chair doesn't need to just be a chair. It could also be a bike or maybe even a laptop. In a really ideal world, you could have a bucket filled with a goo where you could tell the goo to become anything and it would just pop out and there would be the wrench that you want.
So it's like the T-1000 from Terminator 2, only it's not trying to kill you, it's trying to fix your house and make you tea.
Some of the negative implications of having stuff that can turn into just about anything else is, what if your programmable matter gets hacked?
And what do you do if it's hacked?
And what do you do if programmable matter fails at a particularly bad time?
Yeah, like if you make airplane wings and they behave appropriately in a way that goes disastrously wrong, who's to blame for that?
And what about security concerns?
If anything can be anything else includes things like knives and guns. That's tricky.
And what if we accidentally bring about the dreaded gray goo scenario?
In which we create machine life that can reproduce and propagates throughout the planet, consuming everything as it goes.
So we don't know if any of the bad things that we talk about are actually going to happen, but it's important that people have thought about it so that you can try to reduce those negative implications when the technology finally rolls out.
There are lots of really awesome technology scientists are working on right now that can make our lives way better, like precision medicine.
So the idea behind precision medicine is that when you go into a doctor, they look at a lot of different biomarkers to try to figure out if something is wrong with you.
So the idea is you could get toward a future where you have a doctor kind of acting as concierge to a statistics machine.
Hopefully you can hone in on the exact problems and then treat specifically those problems. Medical trials in general could be more efficient and more effective, driving down the cost of producing drugs in the first place. We're not just excited about precision medicine. We're also excited about origami robots.
Bioprinting new organs.
And fusion energy.
And brain-computer interfaces.
And augmented reality.
Bringing asteroids back from space.
This is all awesome stuff. We wanted to get people excited about the problems that remain to be solved, to maybe even motivate some of the generations of people coming into college now to think, these are problems I could solve in my lifetime that could possibly change everything, and hopefully for the better. That got kind of rambly with the economics part, but... Oh wait, am I supposed to say that again?
Yeah.
Oh no, that was a one time. I nailed it once.